Jingju.
Jingju.
Run China, and the world states. Jingju, the Olympics and globalization. One difficulty that arises when discussing traditional Chinese opera using the English language is the difficulty in choosing an adequate translation for the Chinese word Jingju. Various translations include theater of song, music drama, and opera, but none of these really conveys the correct meaning, and most attempts will confuse an English speaker who is already familiar with Western meanings associated with the words theater, music, opera, drama, and play. Most Westerners, though, have some concept of Chinese opera as being quite different from any of this. For this reason, the term Chinese opera is a good start for a translation of Jingju. Before we proceed, let me introduce to you the author of the article. Megan Evans received her MFA in directing and PhD in theater from University of Hawaii at Manoa, where she studied Asian and Western performance history, theory, and practices. She lived in China for 3 years, studying language at Nanjing University in Nanjing and Sikkim Performance Techniques, Theory, and History at the Academy of Chinese Theater Arts and Central Academy of Drama in Beijing. Current research projects, research interests focus on efforts to maintain the aesthetic viability of Jingju in contemporary China, particularly on experimentation in the creation of new Jingju works. She is currently investigating the impact of China's explosive economic growth and shift away from central control and support of arts organizations on the infrastructures for Jingju performance and training in Beijing. She is also a respected icon in the field of theater. Aside from being a researcher and a writer, she is also a part of several performances and a winning stage director. As a proof, here are some outstanding performances of Megan Evans from the different studio and arts festival. As a writer, she is fascinated with China, studying the Chinese culture and preserving Chinese Jingju performances. I would like also to introduce the one who pioneered this Chinese Jingju, and she is the one who established the Chinese Jingju in China, and at the same time she is considered as the China's global superstar, and she is no other than Mei Lanfang. Mei Lanfang is the most famous master of Peking opera in China and was a legend for his outstanding artistic contribution as a cultural ambassador of China and Chinese art. Mei Lanfang became best known as one of the foremost famous Dan performers. These are male artists who represent or impersonate themselves as female characters. Because of his innovations, his unique Oriental opera system became known as the Mei School, which together with the Russian Stanislavski system and the German Brett system form the three performing systems of the world. In bringing the Peking opera to the United States for the first time in 1930, Mei Lanfang received praise from the American media, stating, "Mei Lanfang's art unquestionably surpasses all obstacles existing between the East and the West." While in the US, he formed lasting relationship with luminaries including Charlie Chaplin, Mary Pickford, and New York Mayor James Rolfe Jr. The University of Southern California and Pomona College both presented him with honorary doctorates of literature. With a career that spanned more than 50 years, Mei Lanfang performed more than 100 different roles, winning him international recognition and creating a considerable legacy for the Peking Opera. My report will be focusing on the different topics, and these are the following: modern Peking Opera, the Peking Opera around the world, performers, roles, visual elements, staging stage properties and aesthetic aims, and principles of the movements, and then the aural performance elements. Background of the Jingju old repertoire in the 1950s, inventing traditions, the creation of new Jingju plays, China's 20th century cultural revolution, and Jingju in post-Olympic iterations of Bronze China. Peking Opera or Beijing Opera, or in Chinese, it is Pinyin or Jingju, is the most dominant form of Chinese opera, which combines music, vocal, performance, mime, dance, and acrobatics. It arose in Beijing in the mid-Qing dynasty and became fully developed and recognized by the mid-19th century. The form was extremely popular in the Qing court and has come to be regarded as one of the cultural treasures of China. Major performance troupes are based in Beijing, Chongqing, and Shanghai. The art form is also preserved in Taiwan, where it is also known as Kuchu, or in Chinese, National Opera. It has also spread to other regions such as the United States and Japan. Traditional Peking opera was denounced as feudalist and bourgeois during the Cultural Revolution and replaced with the revolutionary operas as a means of propaganda and indoctrination. After the Cultural Revolution, these transformations were largely undone. In recent years, Peking opera has attempted numerous reforms in response to sagging audience numbers. These reforms, which include improving performance quality, adapting new performance elements, and performing new and original plays, have met with mixed success. Modern Peking Opera. During the second half of the 20th century, Peking opera witnessed a steady decline in audience numbers. This has been attributed both to a decrease in performance quality and an inability of the traditional opera form to capture modern life. In response, Peking opera began to see reform starting in the 1980s. Such reforms have taken the form of creating a school of performance theory to increase performance quality, employing modern elements to attract new audiences, and performing new plays outside of the traditional canon. However, these reforms have been hampered by both a lack of funding and an adverse political climate that makes the performance of new plays difficult. In addition to more formal reform measures, Peking opera troupes during the 1980s also adopted more unofficial changes. Some of those seen in traditional works have been called technique for technique's sake. This has included the use of extended high-pitched sequences by female dan, and the addition of lengthier movement sections and percussion sequences to traditional works. Such changes have generally met with disdain from Peking opera performers, who see them as ploys to gain immediate audience appeal. New works have naturally experienced a greater freedom to experiment. Regional, popular, and foreign techniques have been adapted, including Western-style makeup in birds and new face paint designs for Jin characters. The spirit of reform continued during the 1990s. To survive in an increasingly open market, troupes like the Shanghai Peking Opera Company needed to bring traditional Peking opera to new audiences. To do this, they have offered an increasing number of free performances in public areas. Peking opera around the world. In addition to its presence in mainland China, Peking opera has spread to many other places. It can be found in Hong Kong, Taiwan, and overseas Chinese communities elsewhere. Mei Lan Fang, one of the most famous dan performers of all time, was also one of the greatest popularizers of Peking opera abroad. During the 1920s, he performed Peking opera in Japan. This inspired an American tour in February 1930. Although some, such as the actor Otis Skinner, believed that Peking opera could never be a success in the United States, the favorable reception of May and his troupe in New York City disproved this notion. This is simply because the performances had to be relocated from the 49th Street Theater to the larger National Theater, and the duration of the tour extended from 2 weeks to 5. May traveled across the United States, receiving honorary degrees from the University of California and Pomona College. He followed this tour with a tour in the Union Soviet in 1935. Let's talk about the different performers in Jingju, their roles, visual elements, staging, stage properties and aesthetic aims, and principles of the movements. First, we have the Sheng, the Dan, Jing, and Choi. The Sheng, this is the main role in Beijing opera. This role has numerous subtypes. The Lao Sheng is a dignified older role. These characters have a gentle and cultivated disposition and wear sensible costumes. One type of Lao Sheng role is the Hong Sheng, a red-faced older male. The only two Hong Sheng roles are Guan Gong, the Chinese god of war, and Zhao Guangjin, the first Song Dynasty emperor. Young male characters are known as Xiao Sheng. These characters sing in a high, shrill voice with occasional breaks to represent the voice changing period of adolescence. Depending on the character's rank in society, the costume of the Xiao Sheng may be either elaborate or simple. Offstage, Xiao Sheng actors are often involved with beautiful women by virtue of the handsome and young image they project. The Wu Sheng is a martial character for roles involving combat. They are highly trained in acrobatics and have a natural voice when singing. The Dan refers to any female role in Beijing opera. Dan roles were originally divided into 5 subtypes. Old women were played by Lao Dan, martial women were Wu Dan, young female warriors were Dauma Dan, virtuous and elite women were Xing Yi, and vivacious and unmarried women were Wan Dan. One of Mei Lanfang's most important contribution to Beijing opera was in pioneering a 6th type of role, the Washan. This role type combines the status of the Xing Yi with the sensuality of the Wao Dan. A troupe will have a young Dan to play main roles, as well as an older Dan for secondary parts. For examples of famous Dans are Mei Lanfang, Chang Yanqi, Xiang Xiaoyun and Zun Weishang. In the early years of Beijing opera, all Dan roles were played by men. Wei Xiaosheng, a male Dan performer in the Qing court, developed the Xiao Kai Xiao or false foot technique to simulate the bound feet of women and the characteristic gait that resulted from the practice. The ban on female performers also led to a controversial form of brothel, known as the Xiao Gong Tang Si, in which men paid to have sex with young boys dressed as females. Ironically, the performing skills taught to the youths employed in these brothels led many of them to become professional Dan later in life. The Jing. The Jing is a painted face male role. Depending on the repertoire of the particular troupe, he will play either primary or secondary roles. This type of role will entail a forceful character, so a Jing must have a strong voice and be able to exaggerate gestures. Beijing opera boasts 16 basic facial patterns, but there are over 100 specific variations. The patterns and coloring are thought to be derived from traditional Chinese color symbolism and divination on the lines of a person's face, which is said to reveal personality. Easily recognizable examples of coloring include red, which denotes uprightness and loyalty, white, which represents evil or crafty characters, and black, which is given to characters of soundness and integrity. Three main types of Jing roles are often seen. These include Dong Xue, a loyal general with a black face who excels in singing, Jiaxi, a complex character played by a skilled actor, and Bu Jing, a martial and acrobatic character. The Chou is a male clown role. The Chou usually play secondary roles in a troupe. Indeed, most studies of Beijing opera classify the Chou as a minor role. The name of the role is a homophone of the Mandarin Chinese word Chou, meaning ugly. This reflects the traditional belief that the clown's combination of ugliness and laughter could drive away evil spirits. Chou roles can be divided into Wenchou, civilian roles such as merchants and jailers, and Wuchou, minor military roles. The Wuchou is one of the most demanding in Beijing opera because of its combination of comic acting, acrobatics, and a strong voice. Chou characters are generally amusing and likable, if a bit foolish. Chou actor often uses the gubit in solo performance, especially when performing Shu Ban, light-hearted verses spoken for a comedic effect. The clown is also connected to the small gong and cymbals, percussion instruments that symbolize the lower classes and raucous atmosphere inspired by the role. The Chou has a vocal timbre that is distinct from other characters, as the character will often speak in the common Beijing dialect, as opposed to the more formal dialects of other characters. And the visual performance elements. Peking opera performers use four main skills. The first two are song and speech. The third is dance acting. This includes pure dance, pantomime, and all other types of dance. The final skill is combat, which includes both acrobatics and fighting with all manner of weaponry. All of these skills are expected to be performed effortlessly in keeping with the spirit of the art form. Aural performance elements. Vocal production in Peking opera is conceived of as being composed of four levels of songs. Songs with music, verse recitation, prose dialogue, and nonverbal vocalizations. The conception of a sliding scale of vocalization creates a sense of a smooth continuity between songs and speech. The three basic categories of vocal production technique are the use of breath, pronunciation, and special Peking opera pronunciation. Background of the Jingju old repertoire in the 1950s. This continual process of change is a phenomenon typical not only of May plays, but also of Jingju traditional repertoire as a whole. It seems, on the one hand, that there is a powerful impetus to construe Jingju or the Peking opera as wholly traditionally and purely Chinese. On the other hand, Jingju's constant changes throughout its history formulated an apparent instability of this distinguished genre as of any art form. The first official banning notice and aftermath of the Jingju plays during the olden times. Obviously, Jingju has never been free from banning and oppression since its inception. The official banning policy categorized Pi Wang, the tune of Jingju, Bangzi, Xianzu, Qin Qiang, etc. as vulgar and low entertainments, which offended the public's sense of decency and corrupted the public morals. Thus, the performance of Pi Wang together with other Yubu tunes was specifically banned during 1795 to 1805. Later, because of its popularity, Jingju gradually found favor with the imperial family. Xianpin Su, this is an organization in charge of the performance activities in the court in the late Qing dynasty, began to train eunuchs to perform Jingju for the court entertainment. Since the Jingju troops and actors were summoned frequently by the emperor to the royal theater for performance. Although Jingju was favored by the ruler, it was not freed from banning because of various issues having to do with racial discrimination and the social hierarchy. For example, because Jingju was basically considered a low entertainment for the common people with its vulgar content, obscene lyrics, decadent songs, lascivious dances, lewd expression, and etc., which constitute a severe offense against decency, Manchu emperors strictly banned the royal family and its descendants from performing Jingju, and the Jingju performances were not allowed in the Neicheng unless they were summoned by the emperor. Aside from the hundreds of written Jingju plays, from the first banning, here comes another censoring and revising of the Jingju traditional plays. During the 1950s, beside the outright banning, a series of policies were formulated and measures under the supervision of the Ministry of Culture to reform the Jingju classical plays and regulate their performance in terms of what should be performed, what should be revised for performance, what should be completely gotten rid of, and what kinds of new plays should be created. However, before we can assess the weight of this burden, we should carefully examine the actual process of policy making and its implementation. In our present times, the Jingju, encompassing the international stage, on the evening of March 16, 2009, excerpts from the Jingju or Beijing or the Peking Opera played on a giant LED screens in New York Times Square. Times Square viewers saw footage of famous traditional Jingju characters in a reworked production aspiring to the scale of Western Grand Opera. The Times Square broadcast followed less than a year after the Beijing Olympics opening ceremonies, where the sole Jingju-related performance featured Jingju music and four small puppets that replaced Jingju's live actors in a hastily developed fill-in for a giant puppet segment cut due to technical difficulties. A big presence in Times Square, yet almost nothing at the Beijing Olympics, such contrasting deployment of Jingju are asymptomatic of the continuing internal debate concerning the China's 21st century cultural branding that increasingly emphasizes a synthesis of traditional and contemporary elements. According to Lei 2006, Macera's 2005, Anderson 2006, Apadura in 1996, and Lee 2003, as the forces of globalization threaten to overwhelm national identity, traditional performing arts have been blurring distinctions between national and cultural identities, connecting home and diasporic communities with the force of multinational corporate brand recognition. Now, in the second decade of the 21st century, we see the confluence of disseminated artifacts of popular cultural production and officially approved narratives in the constructions of national and cultural identity. And as they say, as a result of a corporate brand recognition, the image of a Jingju traditional costume, an image of a Jingju fan in a traditional costume and a McDonald's takeout bag are contributing to an emerging internationally legible brand China. Though sometimes derided as an outmoded cultural cliché, Jingju is providing a resilient marker of contemporary Chineseness able to negotiate the complex, often conflicting impulses brand China conveys. Particularly Jingju, the nationally prominent form of CQ since the late 19th century. CQ, as the umbrella term for more than 300 regional forms of Chinese opera. This has served as an arena where official and popular impulses have come together to forge a modern Chinese national identity. In the 1930s, Jingju actor Mei Lan Fang, a self-appointed cultural ambassador, triumphantly toured the United States and Russia, offering a carefully constructed program designed to introduce the Western world to a glorious example of 20th century Chinese cultural expression, simultaneously confirming Jingju's status at home as a nationally representative performance form. May's iconic status have been repeatedly invoked in 21st century iterations of cultural brand China as an internationally legible symbol of the successful synthesis of tradition and modernity. We go back during the Cultural Revolution from 1966 to 1976, when China turned violently inward. The battle over Sikh reform took center stage. Traditional culture was repressed in favor of massive efforts led by Mao's wife, Mao Zedong, the actress Jiang Qing, to create model Jingju works extolling communist ideals of class struggle and resistance to foreign oppression. In the Deng Xiaoping post Mao transition to a market economy and comparative openness, the relationship between cultural identity and Sikh has been less politically charged. Nevertheless, Sikh remains an internationally recognized marker of Chinese cultural identity. According to Daphne P. Wei Lei, in its various contact zones, Chinese opera is often figured as a lotus flower, rising out of putrid mud and resisting hybridity and assimilation, and used to represent a unique, intrinsic, pure, and stable Chinese identity. Yet, without the threat of contamination, such purity could not be envisioned or celebrated. And here are some actual significant conflict and contamination. In 1998, testifying to at least a perception of contamination, the Shanghai Ministry of Culture cancelled an 18-hour-long production of the Kongqiu, Jingju's Ming Dynasty predecessor, masterpiece Mudan Ting at the Peony Pavilion, co-produced by Shanghai Kongju Company and New York's Lincoln Center. On the eve of its departure, Shanghai Ministry of Culture officials accused Chinese-born New York-based director Chen Qicheng of including feudal, superstitious, and pornographic, as well as other inauthentic elements in the production, making it unworthy of the internationally renowned performance venue of Lincoln Center. Another, a reworked and highly acclaimed version of Chen's production was staged a year later, independent of Shanghai Kongju Company and without Chinese government approval. Ironically, two later productions of Peony Pavilion, one by the Kongju Society of New York, the other by the Shanghai Kongju Company funded by the Shanghai government, were derided in the Western press for failing to match Chen's Lincoln Center production's level of authenticity and innovation. The official Chinese concern for Sikh purity that was ostensibly the reason for the 1998 Peony cancellation has diminished markedly in the last decade. Aside from that, Sikh, and particularly Jingju, has been integrated diverse range of contemporary elements to represent brand China. Like other traditional art forms around the world, pressured by film and television, Jingju and other Sikh forms struggle to attract young performers and new audiences in China. One scholar even pronounced Jingju definitely dead, fearing the art form's extinction. The Chinese Ministry of Education initiated a pilot project in 2008 to include Jingju arias in public school music curricula. In 2007, the National Peking Opera Company opened its impressive $14 million Mei Lan Fang Grand Theater. Another, McDonald's global casting stars featured on takeout bags and cups was a young woman in Jingju costume. In 2009, China chose Chen Kai-ge's eponymous biopic of Mei Lan Fang, English title Forever Enthralled, as its entry for a Foreign Language Academy Award. In the same year, the Brand China Industrial Union, whose logo is an abstracted Jingju painted face, began to internationalize its profile. So, We can see here the struggle between the old and the new in China. And then we have some issues on new brand China. This struggle between the old and the new in China is no secret. In a 2007 study for the London-based Foreign Policy Center, Joshua Cooper Ramo diagnosed a dangerous disjuncture between China's image abroad and its own self-perception. Ramo recommended a rebranding of China around the idea of innovation, urging that this process not be whitewashed, but rather include both productive and corruptive changes. If the first adjective people think of to describe China is new, they will be acknowledging the most important, honest, and obvious thing about the country. Its future is unknown because it is still being invented. China is confronting huge problems and looking for even larger innovations to solve them. Discussions on China should be redolent of change and innovation. They should be frank about the failures of reform and the desperate demand for new ideas to help the country. And though this focus on newness runs counter to many current attempts to talk about China as ancient by opening up Confucian institutes around the world, for instance, the world needs no reminder of China's age. What it needs instead is a simple way to understand what is happening in China today. Jingju appeared in three important pre-Olympic sites of synthesis because the Olympics was an opportunity to showcase China as both innovative and traditional. Even it is being celebrated its engagement with today's global world. Meilan Fang's iconic status were directly exploited in two of these. First is the 2004 Peking Opera troupe of Beijing's production, Meilan Fang, honoring the 100th anniversary of May's birth. Second site of synthesis is the National Peking Opera Company's Meilan Fang Grand Theater, which opened in November 2007. The theater's architecture integrates traditional and contemporary elements. The last pre-Olympic site of synthesis I will address did not directly refer to Meilan Fang, but rather instigated the vast consumer encounter with Jingju at McDonald's outlet worldwide. With the performance of China during the Beijing Olympics in 2008, the 2008 Olympics opening ceremony presented huge opportunities as well as challenges for China to reframe its international image. Xin Su notes that the Olympics have provided nation-states with a universally legitimate way to present and promote their national identities and cultures. This is especially true for the host countries. And according to another author, Rich Schinner goes further, labeling the Olympics globalism's signature performance. This is being said because Meilan Fang constructed Jingju as China's iconic performance form and important political and business leaders in China. Beijing Olympics Organizing Committee continue to view it as such, prioritizing Jingju in relation to other cultural products on the international scene. This is evidenced by the cover of the Culture Guide Beijing 2008, where the image of a smiling Jingju performer in a conventional gesture of respectful greeting takes focus, having been printed larger and darker than the muted collage of Caucasian ballet dancers in the background. The message is clear. Jingju is first, or at least equal, among the great global performance traditions. Why then did the first plans for the artistic performance in Olympics opening ceremony not include Jingju? And another question, and how did it happen that when Jingju was finally shown, the brief segment was bungled? The answer likely lies in the fact that Beijing's contribution to the 2004 Athens Olympics closing ceremony, which included tag-twirling Jingju performers along with the Red Lanterns and Kung Fu artists was criticized for reducing China's ancient culture to superficial cultural cliché, and the 2008 Jingju segment was a hurried replacement for a segment depicting the Shaanxi Terracotta Warriors, which was deleted after technical glitches arose during dress rehearsals. However, as we will see, the reasons for not showing the warriors are more complex. Several dauntless reactions on the Olympic performance. According to the Chinese press, Zhang Jimu hoped to ensure that foreigners would understand the imagery and symbolism represents. According to the China Central Television or CCTV website, after the performance, says that here are peach blossoms, romantic and enjoyable, adequately demonstrating the sweet wish of peace-loving Chinese people. But NBC's Ramo, in a striking revision of the officially constructed narrative, commented, "And now, in a moment of symbolism that is just remarkable, the director Zhang Yimou brings the Great Wall down and replaces it with blossoming plum flowers, the Chinese symbol for openness." While BBC viewers saw images interpreted as emphasizing a China proud of its elegant, traditional, ancient, romantic history but not afraid to modernize, NBC viewers had that event framed by a narrative of innovation, openness, and the creativity of the individual. The segment was described in the Chinese official English language press as a precaution performance of traditional Peking opera of China. This odd phrasing seems to devolve from the fact that the orchestra was the only Jingju element in the segment and was perhaps designed to disrupt a potential misreading of the scene by viewers unfamiliar with Jingju, namely that Jingju is a puppet form. Some violent reactions coming from the different people, coming from the different audiences and viewers, asking how did Jingju fare on the opening ceremonies, a plane of transnationalism far from traditional. Controversial with some sections of the Chinese public, they feel this is an older image of China, Kung Fu, Confucianism, the enormous numbers of people involved in an almost robotic movements. There are some Chinese who don't want to see this side of China presented. They'd rather see a more modern version. The segment was described in the Chinese official English language press as a percussion performance of traditional Peking opera of China. This odd phrasing seems to devolve from the fact that the orchestra was the only Jingju element in the segment and was perhaps designed to disrupt a potential misreading of the scene by viewers unfamiliar with Jingju, namely that Jingju is a puppet form. The segment was uniquely uncinematic and ineffective as a large-scale arena spectacle. The puppets were less than half human height, and their movements too jerky and their limbs too small to be seen clearly in the video. Moreover, the group movement of actors surrounding the performance platform was some of the least complex of the evening, and far from the thrilling traditional Jingju group movement sequences that could have been used. The mapping of squares and corners by the group of performers was a distinctly inappropriate way to portray Jingju's core aesthetic of roundness, whereas the inner fictional layer of other segments was readily accessible. The Jingju-derived segment was rendered opaque by the ineffective communication of any narrative relationship between surrounding throng of actors and the action of the puppet. Jingju's misrepresentation in the eye candy that was the Olympics opening ceremonies doesn't affect its cultural relevance, as economic prosperity has allowed China to invest in revitalizing the forum. The Times Square broadcast constitutes a recognizably postmodern intermedial and transnational bridging of elite and popular expressions of national identity, and is comparable to New York's Metropolitan Opera and the British National Theatre's screenings of live performances at movie theaters around the world. Similarly, the decision to place Forever Enthralled into Oscar's contention shows official China's persistent desire to foreground Jingju on the international cultural scene. Years after the Olympics, Jingju maintains a presence in global commercial branding. The BMW localized its 2010 Global Joy campaign with ads and posters, placing its new hybrid car in front of a Jingju painted face, positioned so that the car's headlights appear to be the eyes of the design. Brand China Industries Union mission is to build a new image for Chinese brand and reshape the global brand landscape. The organization describes its China's face logo as an abstract Peking opera mask and explains the logo's color according to Jingju's symbolism: red for loyalty and bravery, black for integrity, selflessness, and progress. In 2009 and 2010, it co-sponsored a massive Brand China Festival, including an opening ceremony at the Great Hall of the People in Beijing in August 2010. The theme of the 2010 Brand China Festival was Return and Transcend. Return to traditional ethics in the wake of product scandals like the discovery of toxic melamine in baby milk powder. Transcend China's status as manufacturing giant, being the imitator, into branding giant as the innovator. The China's face logo combines tradition and innovation with a similar goal of instilling international recognition and confidence. Resilient and flexible, synthesizing tradition and innovation, Jingju is now a central component of a multifaceted intersection of popular and elite cultural products and modes of dissemination that characterize an emerging 21st century brand China.